sometimes I think in the church that you and I have grown up that we take for granted that everyone understands certain vocabulary. And today we have a great example of that. We hear of God's grace. Yet when you ask people to define what grace is, it becomes very individual and unique, and the definition keeps eluding us. Interestingly, this week I've had several experiences with people who have talked to me about the difference between mercy and grace. And so I shared this with you that a friend had told to me. Mercy is when we don't receive things that we should. Grace is a free gift that just pours out upon us that we receive and we should. Yet John would tell you and I that there is a third dimension to grace. A third dimension that is powerfully illustrated in this John's first story about the public teaching and miracles of Jesus Christ. John says that grace is truly a free gift, that it's a generous gift, and it's an abundant gift, as in more than you can possibly fathom or imagine. Think for a moment. This wedding feast that you and I just heard about was in its third day. Traditionally, in the ancient world, wedding feasts lasted 3 days. And it's on this third day that we're told that the wine runs out for the feast. So people have literally been partying for 2 full days. And when we think of partying, think Fort Lauderdale, spring break kind of partying, celebrating the union of these two people. Now, Jesus, at the urgent request of his mother, turns water into wine. But Jesus doesn't just give wine that will last through the day. No, Jesus takes 180 gallons of water and turns it into wine. And not just any wine, the finest wine that anyone had ever tasted. Jesus doesn't simply give the bride and the groom a gift that sees them through their momentary need. Jesus gives this couple a blessing that flows beyond their wildest imagination. For John, grace from a loving God is overflowing in joy. It's overflowing in blessing. And it's overflowing in abundance. This is truly a timely message for the people who lived in the first century of Judea. For their lives were lives that were filled daily with the scarcity that surrounded them in the world. Daily, they would awaken to wonder what kind of food they would be able to forage to eat through the day. Daily, they wonder, will we have enough to survive the day? Daily, they wonder, will they be threatened by the Roman oppressive government? Will they be safe in the homes that they leave? Don't be misled, though. This message is timely for you and I in the year of the Lord 2016 also. Don't be misled, because we are constantly told that we live in a world of scarcity. Do we have enough money to see us through our retirement into our elder years? Do we have a house that's as grandiose as we'd like to live in? Do we have enough security in our homes when thieves and hoodlums run amok in our city streets? Do we have enough power and authority to influence the people who are closest to us in our lives? Do we have enough privilege? This idea of scarcity is one of the reasons that this week's Powerball lottery yielded its greatest result, right? Because everyone in our country wants to swing for the fences in one fell swoop, go from scarcity to an overflowing abundance of, I believe it was $1.6 billion. And if we had that $1.6 billion, all of our problems would be solved. Of course, you had a better chance of finding a needle in the middle of the Philadelphia Eagles football field when the stadium was closed. Whenever you and I experience a political season, such as we're in right now, we hear a lot about the things we don't have, right? Our politicians see to it that you and I know that we have scarcity, that the kind of life that we want to lead isn't available right now in the current political climate, that you and I really aren't safe in the world because of the world political climate. And these politicians and the media and marketers go about their business, and they do an incredible job of using their creative energies, their efforts, and their monies to convince us all that indeed we live in a land of scarcity, that they have the plan to fix it, and that all it takes is our vote or our money or our support to make the world a better place, that you and I might live in a land of abundance overflowing with milk and honey. Of course, our human DNA just doesn't help in this matter. We're hardwired, it seems, to pay attention to those places in our lives that are scarce or out of order or not quite right. How many times do we look into our bulletins and find all the mistakes that are made within there without realizing that 98% of the bulletin is accurate and correct? How often in our lives do we look for those places that just seem, well, off? Because we want to make sure that everything is perfect instead of acknowledging that we're human and subject to human error and failure, but we could rejoice in all those blessings that are present in our days. And those marketers, those politicians, all those media outlets will continue to do their very best to convince you and I that we are in need. We are in need of something greater than we possess. Far too often in the history of the church, we've taught that the good news of Jesus Christ is also a scarce commodity. We've taught the world that we live in that Jesus Christ came among us as an infant child, lived and dwelt among us as a young man, performed miracles among us, taught us and lived this life, and eventually walked to the cross and was resurrected in order that those who believe will find forgiveness, mercy, and grace. And we suggested to the world in which we live, whether it was through our proclaimed word or the actions that we perform, that somehow this grace is limited in scope. Somehow this grace doesn't overflow from those who believe now to all of the human race. Somehow, only those who are in the know will indeed be saved. Yet, for the gospel writer John, he reminds us this morning that God's graces aren't only making up for the things that you and I might lack, but it's about providing more than you and I can possibly begin to imagine. It's about exceeding your wildest expectations for what it's like to have a life less in God's presence. For John, that's what grace looks like. It flows to each and every individual in the human race through the Spirit and gives each one of us a special measure of gifts. I share with you a story that a friend of mine shared with me this week. This man was on the fast track to reaching his potential in the company in which he worked. He was working hard. He was doing all the things that the world required, and he succeeded. He reached his goal in this company. And then one day, as he was walking around his company, a series of events unfolded, and he realized that he was better suited for employment in that company at a job a little lesser than the job he had. And so he stepped down from his position and took this lower position. But that lower position brought him incredible joy, brought meaning to his vocation. And eventually he succeeded even beyond his wildest imagination as he became a corporate head for this task. That's a person who senses his own calling of the Spirit, who senses his own strength within him, and abandons everything to get those gifts, to use those gifts in deeply powerful ways. I share with you the story of Lee Phillips, a young man of 23 years who was born with severe Asperger's. And Wade, if he walked into our midst, you and I would never know there was a thing wrong with him until you saw him hug every single last one of you, because he has complete trust in people. His inability, or his disability, is in his inability to not trust. He trusts everyone and shares love with them willingly. Shares love with them in abundance, and shares love with them in dramatic gifts of artistic ability. The same is true in our community of faith. And trust me when I tell you, mainline denominations across our country. During this time of the year, every congregation will sit down and they'll look at their numbers from the year that was. And what will they see? They'll see a decline in numbers, a decline in money. They'll see a decline in people who are interested in proclaiming the word of the Lord. But what those numbers will not show is the abundant gifts that lie within the community itself. If someone walks into our house of the Lord right now, needing a warm smile, a hug, truly being surrounded by people who love and care about each other and have a sense of who they are as children of God, then St. Peter's has grace in abundance. And it's a gift we're called to share with the world around us. When the world around us continues to need food and because they're hungry, this is a place where you can bring your abundant food on a weekly basis to share with people in our community less fortunate than ourselves, to give them a measure of God's grace. This is a place in which we understand that there are people in the world who are still cold. They're still in need of shelter. But in this place, at this time, we have people who willfully share themselves making warm blankets to share with the world around us. Folks, we are not in scarcity. We live in abundance. Enjoy. Thank the Lord each and every day for the abundant gifts that lie within our midst. Thank the Lord each and every day that you as individuals have been gifted with measures of the Spirit in order to share the word of Jesus Christ with the world in which we live. Thank the Lord for the abundance of family that God has given you to proclaim the word here on the corner of Packer and Vine. Thank the Lord that you and I live in a time and a place not molded and shaped by scarcity, but we're God's children. know the abundant life of living with our Lord.